My name's Yang Huang, and I go by Linda at my other life, working as a computer engineer at Cal. I was born and raised in mainland China. I grew up reading political propaganda. As a teenager, I found relief in reading French novels in translation. They opened my eyes and showed me that literature could be about ordinary and flawed people rather than a tool for political agenda. 首先让我做一个自我介绍，我名字叫黄洋，我在伯克利大学做电脑工程师，我是在江苏省长大的。小时候读的中国现代文学，都是些革命小说，或是控诉文革的作品，里面的人物描写比较夸张，有点高大上，不怎么对我的胃口。初中的时候，我迷上了法国文学。 这些19世纪的外国人似乎更加接近我的心灵，然后我就一发不可收拾，读了很多翻译文学、中篇和长篇小说。那时候我想长大了去法国，学习法语写作。I studied physics during the 2 years of college. I loved science, which to me is abstract and beautiful, very much like the arts. I came to the US to study computer science. At first, I didn't like engineering. It was too concrete and hands-on. It felt like a blue-collar job. But I was grateful to work as an engineer. It makes me feel grounded, useful, and problem-solving is addictive compared to writing, excruciating personal evolution. The engineering work feels like instant gratification. 我在上海同济大学读了2年应用物理，我喜欢数理科，因为比较抽象，逻辑性强，其实和艺术很接近。我19岁来到美国学习计算机，一开始我真的不喜欢，因为太实用了，根本就像是体力活。但是我以工程师的身份找到工作，可以办绿卡，这是非常幸运的。日而久之，我也爱上自己的工作，不但立稳脚跟，还有助社会。比起写作爬格子的孤独日子，我的工作让我助人为乐，帮助别人解决问题是很有成就感的。So you can marry a job and then fall in love with it. But I wasn't satisfied. Having a job is to earn my keep from society. Writing is to give back to the community, my soul, my struggle, my faith in humanity and future. So I had a midlife crisis at age 23, which might be a typical immigrant experience. I went back to school part-time, worked full-time, and kept quiet about it. I took English writing courses, eventually earned an MFA in fiction. Most importantly, I have kept writing. 所以说，在求职这个问题上，我们还是应该脚踏实地。但是我并不满足。我是89年以后来到美国的，对我来说，当年背井离乡不仅仅是为了一份稳定的工作，我有一种使命感，要为社区贡献出我的力量，真正成为美国社会的一分子。所以我23岁的时候， 有了一次中年危机，我知道自己不能够破釜沉舟投身艺术的，所以我全职上班，业余时候去学习英语写作。我得到了英语本科、硕士和写作硕士的学位。最关键的是，我坚持小说创作。This collection is not new. I wrote the stories years ago and published them in the literary journals. At the time, I couldn't get the book published, so I began to writing novels. I published Living Treasures 4 years ago, but My Old Faithful is my real debut. In this collection, all the stories stand alone but want to become longer. They're interconnected with reoccurring themes, settings, and characters. So the book becomes a bigger family novel than the individual stories. For those of you who have read Living Treasures, you know that I love to write about nature, society, family, and the aspects of society that impinge on individuals. 我的中层花其实是我的处女座。四年前我出版了小说《国宝》，受到多方好评，得到了 Nautilus 图书奖。许多对中国一无所知的读者对故宝的故事有强烈的共鸣。我有不少华裔读者和家长交流写作经验和培养中学生阅读习惯的培养。我的中层花是有关联的 短篇小说集讲的是一个80年代的普通中国家庭，这个五口之家有父母、两女儿和一个儿子。在座有些朋友也许看过《国宝》，你知道我喜欢描写大自然、社会和家庭息息相关的故事。I shelved this book after a number of rejections. I waited several years and finally submitted to the Juniper Prize. To my astonishment, my Old Faithful was selected to be the winner for fiction. My first reaction was, could this be a fluke? You know, I submitted in August 2016. After the November election that year, I went into some kind of stupor and questioned everything I had taken for granted, my beliefs and values, and my priorities in life. Unbeknownst to myself, it developed into a personal crisis. I like to consider myself a survivor, even though I had a more or less normal childhood. It wasn't easy to grow up in China, where human rights violation and censorship was a matter of life. Privacy was non-existent, individualism was frowned upon, and even creativity was suspect. I'm grateful to become immigrant writer because I wouldn't have written fiction in China if I still lived in China. We made our home in the Bay Area, and my children were born in Berkeley. Now they're teenagers, and Trump is a president. This beautiful country that once infused me with hope and dreams now fills with me trepidation for an uncertain future. Intellectually, I can understand that some Americans take democracy for granted, but it doesn't soften the blow. For months, I had not been able to sleep at night. I slept worse than the days after childbirth. 当年我的中层花没有发表，我就把它放在一边。很多年过去了，然后2016年，我投稿《Juniper》奖项，意外的得了头奖。 我想不会搞错吧，当时正是大选以后，我好像经历了一场腥风血雨。我在中国长大，其实从来不对政府寄予什么厚望。可是我们的孩子是出生在 Berkeley， 突然他们有了一个我们很不习惯的总统，这也变成了我们陌生的美国。我心里很担忧，但是无能为力，只想得过且过。 可是我的深层担忧让我长久失眠。我比生完孩子后睡得还要少，整天感到浑浑噩噩。When the news of my little book came, I became like a mother, ready to birth a new book. I read these stories and became reacquainted with my younger self, who had a burning desire to tell these emotional stories. In case you're wondering, these stories are not autobiographical. There are two sisters in the book, but I don't have a sister. Although the events are fictional, the people and place are real. I modeled the stories on my family and other families I knew during my teen years. We used to live in a community of 6 apartment buildings. The residents were professors and staff's family at Yangzhou Teachers College. My parents, like all Chinese parents, compared my brother and me to our schoolmates who excelled in studies or had a special talent. It was normal for us to have anxiety and feel inadequate. 当我知道这本书会发表的时候，我决定振作起来。我的故事集讲的是我青少年时候的成长故事。我的家住在江苏扬州。 邻居们是我父母的同事，那时候有很多学校里的同伴，他们非常努力，也极为出色，所以父母会拿我和弟弟他们做比较，我们还是有很不少心理压力的。 I'm curious, how many of you here have had teenage children? 请问在座哪些人有青少年孩子？ Oh, not that many here. Several, yeah, including myself. Thank you for being here. My sons are 13 and 15 this year. I can commiserate with you about parenting this precious, intelligent, and sensitive young people. For the rest of you, do you remember the time when you were teenagers? How your parents seemed so banal and old-fashioned? Then you're sure you'll grow up to be different. Well, congratulations. You're far more technologically adept than your parents. 我的孩子们今年十三十五了，都比我高了，而且很多地方比我能干很多。I'm a computer engineer by profession, but my 13-year-old programmed my iPhone to enter all his fingerprints, none of mine, in my phone. When he called Siri, all three of our phones answered to his voice. When my husband, who has a PhD in computer science, couldn't get his voice activation to work. Smartphones and gadgets aside, we all come families with teenagers. I can count on you to understand some of the struggles from children's perspectives, and parents' too. 我是电脑工程师，可是我十三岁的儿子把我的电话拿去输入自己的指纹，然后他喊了一声，家里三个电话一起回应。我先生是计算机博士，可是我们有时候把新的电器交给小宝来管理操作，这叫后生可畏。长江后浪推前浪，我们都来自有青少年的家庭，我相信每个人都理解成长的轨迹，可是一代代人生生不息，成长的眼泪和欢笑又是极为相似的。 My fictional family has five people, father, mother, two daughters, and a son. Each person tells two stories about the defining moments of their lives, and they're peripheral characters in other people's stories. The characters are honest with themselves when other people are not eavesdropping.I was drawn to the moments of weakness when an outwardly decent person makes a bad decision. To give you a feel of the stories, I want to read the opening scene of a story, The Umbrella. Now imagine I'm a 44-year-old father with three children, the youngest a 15-year-old daughter. 我故事集的人物是基本正直的，可是他们一时糊涂或者软弱，犯了错误。或者有视觉盲点。下面我会读一段爸爸在雨伞这个故事里对小女儿的温柔呵护，显示了他年轻时候缺乏的耐心。 A clap of thunder seems to rip open a hole in the sky. I watch rain pelt down in hard sheets from the upstairs balcony and worry about my younger daughter, who's stranded at school.Lian is not a strong kid. Last night, she complained about menstrual cramps. I mustn't let her be soaked on the way home and catch a death of cold. I take out the largest umbrella from storage and dust it off. May has come before I could have our rain gear fixed. Two of its bamboo ribs are broken, so a corner of the oilcloth is drooping. It cannot be folded into a backpack or opened with a flick of finger.I push against the wall to slide the runner up the shaft until it clicks with a squeak. A giant taupe canopy shadows me as I hold up an antique, the only umbrella useful in this downpour. I close up but to put on my raincoat, then hurry away to Lian's school. Nearing a noodle shop, I catch sight of a tall young man who stands in the doorway holding open his raincoat. The hair on the back of his head is wet and smooth, gleaming jet black. passing by him, I become curious about the face the man wears with this fine physique, so I peer back. He bows his head with one cheek pressing a young woman's temple. There behind the breast's raincoat hides a little face of my 15-year-old daughter. I whisper, "Lian," and clears my throat. Lian loosens her grip on the man's waist. With the bangs heaped to one side on her forehead, she appears more surprised than I do. I'm almost too ashamed to speak, but she asks me, "Dad, what are you doing here?" I thump the ground with my umbrella. "I brought you this so you wouldn't get drenched." From the corner of my eye, I feel the young man watch me. "Professor Chen," he calls me. I glare at Lian while he explains. "You taught child psychology my sophomore year. I'm from the physical education department. We now practice teaching at Lian's high school." I thrust the umbrella into Lian's hands. "Take this and go home." The young man steps into the rain, but I wave him back. "You don't have to follow us home. Give me your name and a phone number. We have to talk." So what do you think of this man? He seems to be a loving and protective father. In this story, he takes a strong ethical stand on a teacher's role as an educator and a parental figure. The 10 family stories span over three decades, from 1960s to 1990s in China and the US, before the internet, social media, and cell phones. People talked and listened to one another, wrote letters and postcards by hand. The story is about sexual awakening, sibling rivalry, pain and joy of raising children, and aging. On the surface, it is a loving and protective family. Underneath, their secret strivings, jealousy, betrayal, pain, as well as joy and constraints of love or loyalty that bind and separate family across time and space. 这本书每个人我讲两个故事，都是关于他们人生转折点的故事，包括初恋、兄弟姊妹之间的争端。 成长和衰老等等的问题，表面上这个家庭很和睦，可是暗地里有很多争端、嫉妒、背叛、痛苦，也有意想不到的温柔和忠诚。里面提到的心理历程是很多人都会经历，每个人都会经历的，所以不同文化背景的读者也会产生强烈的共鸣。As we saw earlier, the father is essentially a decent person, but he wasn't always so patient and kind. Otherwise, I wouldn't have several stories here. Now, 8 years later, his teenage daughter grows up and studies in the US. She brings home a brown man to meet her conservative parents. I'll read a scene from her story, The Gourmet, told by the younger daughter. Now imagine I'm a 23-year-old engineer who works for Siemens Data Communications and lives in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'm on vacation to visit my parents in China, and my colleague Amal travels to China to see me at home. 下面我读一段妹妹的故事。她出国留学三年后，带回来一位棕色皮肤的印度男友，让父母吃惊不小。 Amal looks like a dark giant planted in the middle of our living room, towering above my mother. His head is only inches under the ceiling fan, and his slouching shoulders seem foolish and out of place, but a dear to my sight. "Amal," I call him. He spins around, causing the bulk of his body to momentarily lose its balance. "You're here," I shout. With a laugh, I wrap my arms around his stout back. He smells of a lightly pungent perfume. "How are you, Lian?" He brushes my elbow with his fingertips. I squeeze him hard, then let him go. If Mom had not been watching us, I would have realized the day is really too hot for hugging. "Has he eaten?" Mom asks in a timid voice. I marched to the kitchen to pick out two tofu dishes and chives with scrambled eggs. I filled a bowl with rice. Why don't you take out some meat dishes? Mom asks. Your friend will think we're stingy.
He doesn't eat meat, I tell her.
Then how did he grow so tall?
I ignore her.
It's a miracle for a flight to be an hour and a half ahead of schedule, a most loud voice echoes in the bathroom. Fortunately, I had a first class ticket. All my bones would have been hurting after crouching in the seat for 20 hours.
He stomps out with his sleeves rolled up to his elbows, showing his hairy forearms.
It's so good to see you again, he says with water on his grinning face. I missed you at work.
What did he say? Mom asks.
I pull out a chair to invite Amal to sit down. Mom, I can't carry on conversation if you ask me to translate everything.
Amal thanks me. Has your mom said something about me? He whispers to me.
Yes, I smile. She wishes you a good appetite. That will make her happy. As you can imagine, the mother's very curious about Amal. So when she sleeps with her daughter in the same bed that night, they gossip about him.
Your friend looks awfully tanned, Mom says. Has he gotten a lot of sun?
Amal is Indian, you know.
He has long hairs on his arms. He eats with his hands.
I shake my head angrily, making the pillow crunch under my neck.
Other than that, he's not bad looking. But I'm worried he's such a big man, and you're a fine-boned skinny girl. The marital life...
Mom stops short because I burst out laughing. For 3 years, I hadn't heard the marital life as a euphemism for sex. I press my face on the pillow and let the fine bamboo mat squeeze a few tears out of my eyelids.
What's tickling your funny bone? Mom rubs my shoulder blade. You see what I'm getting at?
I pick my head up from the pillow.
What do you mean, Mom? That he's too much a man for me?
He's a big fella.
Well, I've had boyfriends.
The air seems to freeze inside the mosquito net for a minute. Then I smell the delicate aroma of sweet olive and Yulan magnolia. The scent raises goose flesh on my arms.
You've never told me.
Mom pawns the mat with her cupped hand.
I feel like old fogey.
I blush to the roots of my hair. I have never with Amal.
How were they?
She asks, wide-eyed like a child. I roll away from her as far as I can go until the mosquito net covers my face like a gauze mask. I suck a patch of cloth between my teeth, tasting the clean gauze.
They're only human, Mom. Only human.
So the somewhat naive mother gets a belated sex education from her daughter. Life can teach and humble you in unexpected ways. A couple of stories resonate with the Me Too movement. I'd rather have you read them and tell me what you think. Sexual harassment has been pervasive throughout human history. This is nothing new. What is new is awareness about how harmful it is. Unfortunately, a person may first encounter a sexual harassment in the family. I decide not to shy away from a dark story and look it straight in the eye, so to speak. It requires a lot of courage not to tamper with the characters and let them surprise and teach me who they really are.
这里有些亲爱的故事，有个故事让读者联想到现在的 Me Too movement. 其实性侵是人类社会一直存在的问题。我们现在意识到的危害，这是社会的进步。我小说里的妹妹守住自己，对哥哥的侵犯奋起反抗，但是她受到心灵的创伤，不再盲目信任。
小说里雨伞讲的是爸爸对女儿的呵护，他阻挠青年教师和女儿恋爱，
因为教师和学生的关系是长辈和晚辈的关系，不可以滥用孩子的信任。这是他的伦理观，可是他不知道女儿在家里已经有了惨痛的教训。这两个故事反映了情爱的伦理和家庭的关系，和现在的 Me Too Movement 是相为呼应的。
When I wrote the book, I identified with the children and took a jab at the parents. Finally, I could get into their heads, walk about and throw my weight around. By the time I have the book, my children are taller than I. I have gained sympathy for a difficult parenting job that is so fluid and in a way seemingly thankless during the teen years. You don't get objective feedback perhaps until decades later. Even in hindsight, you're not sure how you can do better than your parents because children expect more from me today. My American children don't abide by the same obligation as my brother and I once did. Now they have cell phones, internet, social media, and even Trump. The supportive role of the family becomes paramount because you don't get a second chance.There are no hard and fast rules about perfect parenting. You take the journey but wind up in a different place than you intended. So your beliefs about duty, opportunity, and happiness are challenged every day. When you go with a discovery, your heart is in the right place. You take a detour and are humbled and thereby find yourself and discover love in unexpected places.For every cruel trick life throws at you, you can remain courageous by keeping your heart and mind open and may find hope and kindness to pull you through.
我写这本书的时候还没有孩子，现在我的小宝都比我高了。无论在中国还是美国，育人都是百年大计。我的美国孩子们不受到中国教育的约束，可是他们有自己的难题和苦衷。和我们这代人不同，他们有手机，有网络，还有我们没有经历过的许多政治争端。所以家庭的指导和帮助是极为重要的，因为光阴不会重来。
My grandfather used to say, just as the leaves of a tree show its health, the children of a family demonstrate its wealth. My children are in middle and high schools now.I'm still in denial when they tell me that they don't need my help anymore. When they were in elementary school, I was so mad when I heard that they practiced the school lockdown. But now, I'm worried that they don't practice lockdown drill. Can we treat it like earthquake drill? They told me, don't worry, Mom. I'm grateful for the courage.Today, I can compare the March for Our Lives movement to the Tiananmen Square protests in my youth. In 1989, I marched for democracy with millions of people, not just students, but also teachers, workers, and people from all walks of life. For a short while, there seemed to be a real possibility that democracy and political reform could come to China. Our hope was dashed by Tiananmen Square massacre.Then came the crackdown and conspiracy theory that students were used by the senior officials for the political gains. Those leaders were subsequently ousted, and the protests and massacre were censored behind the great firewall of China and erased from the collective memory.Today, a similar conspiracy theory was used to discredit the March for Our Lives activists, but we know it is a lie. I came to U.S. shortly after the crackdown.
我的爷爷曾经说过，树看叶子，人看后代。现在我的孩子们读初中和高中。他们读小学的时候，我听说他们演习躲避枪击手，一群孩子们拥挤在厕所里，大气不敢出。我听了很生气，觉得这太荒唐了。可是现在我还唠叨他们怎么不演习了，关键时候能够救命的。孩子们说，妈妈不要担心，
我很钦佩他们的勇气。今年的生命大游行让我联想到当年我经历过的八九学运。1989年我参与了全国如火如荼的示威运动，有学生、老师、工人和社会各界人士。当时政治变革和民主似乎是触手可及的，但是天安门事件打破了我们的梦想，然后便是强压政策、审查制度，学生们被说成高层领导人利用的工具，这些领导人被撤职后，天安门事件就完全被遗忘了。现在的生命大游行的年轻学生们也说成被政客利用，可是我们知道真相。I'm grateful for America's peaceful transition power, which could not have happened in China. Yet the new erosion of principles, morality, and decency takes a toll on the public life as well as the private life. Resistance is for survival, because if we're not careful, soon, before we know it, our children will be left with nothing to squander.As we come to a precipice, there will be no safety net. Grace, honor, or compassion to catch our falling. Do I need to tell you that after working on this collection, I was finally able to sleep again? I'm still worried about our country and will go out at every election. But deep down in my heart, I know we have the most powerful arsenal of all time.That is family. We are bigger and more resilient than problems. Every one of us is unique, flawed, fragile, yet powerfully human. Please reach out and touch one another with your compassion, humility, and courage before it is too late.
我对美国权力的和平过渡很感恩，不是每个国家都能够做到的。可是现在许多原则、道德的底线受到挑战。公民的抵制是为了生存。假如我们不在意的话，很快我们就会走到悬崖边上，脚下不会再有一张安全网。没有恩典、荣誉或是恻隐之心，再向前一步，便是万丈深渊。坦白地说，我修改完这本书以后才从失眠中走出来，我还是有很多担忧，可是我心里知道我们是有力量的。家庭是每个人出生成长的港湾和走向社会之前的必经之路。真切解读你家庭里的每一个成员，感受你的位置和责任，具有深远的意义。我们每个人都是独特的、脆弱的，有缺陷，但也有无穷的潜力。善待自己和他人，会让我们的世界更公正、和平和美好。现在我要读一段妈妈的故事，我的忠诚花。
I want to read you the opening scene of a title story, My Old Faithful. Now imagine I'm a 51-year-old mother with 3 grown children.As soon as I set foot in the nursery's garden, I find the auspicious flower, a red double peony. So this is what it looks like. Its huge blossoms burst forth as if brimming over with rose-red joy. I stand in awe, what the store clerk tells me, its strong stems never fall, even in the harshest weather. Its name, Old Faithful, makes it perfect for my home.As my husband and I are going to have our 30th wedding anniversary in 2 weeks.
Yes, I say.
I carry the potted peony to the storefront. My husband's talking to a young woman with a fluffy, chrysanthemum-like hairdo. Can you give me a hand? I call out to him. The woman glances at me, backs away to the crowd, and boards the bus.My husband takes my heavy pot and clamps it onto the back seat of his bike. You scared with some business, he tells me with a smile.
What sort of business?
The body kind. He crisscrosses his pot with nylon rope and fastens a dead knot. I'm pretty sure she's a prostitute.
You mean she wanted you?
He pushes bike onto the sidewalk.
Am I not a man? Don't I have a wallet?
Watch your mouth.
I feel a sharp pain in my back and grab the seat of his bike. My fibroids are acting up again. I've had them for more than 10 years. Now I'm beginning to have belly and back pains.
My husband took me to the hospital this morning and doctor suggested I have a hysterectomy to have both my uterus and ovaries removed. I told her I had to think about it. Upset, I left the hospital with a single thought that I'd buy something nice to cheer me up. I found the Old Faithful, but what's the use of that if my husband is bent on ruining my day?
You carry on like this and make sure that bad luck follows my heels, I accuse him.
Take it easy, he holds my hand and squeezes it gently. She wants business and we don't, so there's no transaction. End of story.
I watch the crowd moving the street. Young men and women dressing white, fawn, lavender, and dark summer outfits that bring out their radiant faces. No one knows I'm about to lose my uterus, with which I have carried 3 children. Here I stand on sidewalk in the midday sun, feeling stranded on an island of youth with my old man.
Look at you, I stroke his sunken cheek, his lustrous skin. You're not too wrinkled for a 53-year-old, I guess.
He wraps his arm around my waist and pushes the bike with his free hand.
Wife, you are shapely 51-year-old.
这个妈妈辛苦养育了3个孩子们成人，她被查出有子宫肌瘤，要做子宫切除术。这时候，一个年轻妓女和她的先生谈话，交谈要招揽生意。你说这妈妈有多委屈？可是冰冻三尺，非一日之寒。你一手养育的家庭，应该也是你的归宿。This
cover image is a paper-cutter peony. You cut it out a piece of red paper by pulling it through a scissor blades. You have to do it right in one cut. I cannot go back to fix the curves.
It's a metaphor. Whatever the family has done to you, we carry forward and will pass it down in generations.
这个封面是牡丹的一个品种，叫做老忠臣，深红色的。这是一张剪纸。 你把一张红纸从头剪到尾，一气呵成，不能修改润色，这是家庭的一个暗喻。无论你成长在什么样的家庭，它对你的影响是一生一世的。你会把家庭的影响代代相传。感谢各位。Thank you.